The theme of our lecture for today is peculiarities of Romanticism in English literature. Objectives of the lecture. After the lecture, students should be able to define and explain the Romanticism in English literature, identify some of the major ideas of the Romanticism, explain the impact of Romanticism in English literature, acquaint with the bright representatives of Romanticism and their works. During this lecture, we are going to discuss the following questions: the characteristics of Romanticism, early Romanticism representatives, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, William Wordsworth, Robert Southey, and Walter Scott. As we look back today over the literature of the last three quarters of the 18th century, the progress of the Romantic movement seemed the most conspicuous general fact which it presents. But at the death of Cowper, the movement still remained tentative and incomplete, and it was to arrive at full maturity only in the work of the great writers of the following quarter century, who were to create the finest body of literature which England had produced since the Elizabethan period. All the greatest of these writers were poets, and they fall roughly into two groups. First, William Wordsworth, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, Robert Southey, and Walter Scott. And second, about 20 years younger, Lord Byron, Percy Shelley, and John Keats. These periods of romantic triumph or of the life of its authors coincides in time and not by mere accident with the period of the successful of the French Revolution. The beginning of the romantic triumph is found by general consent in the publication in 1798 of the little volume of lyrical ballads which contained the first significant poetry of Wordsworth and Coleridge. Even during this its great period, however, Romanticism had for a time a hard battle to fight, and a chief literary fact of the period was the founding and continuous success of the first two important English literary and political quarterlies, the Edinburgh Review and the Quarterly Review, which in general stood in literature for the conservative 18th century tradition and violently attacked all the romantic poets. These quarterlies are sufficiently important to receive a few words in passing. In the late 18th century, there had been some periodicals devoted to literary criticism, but they were mere an authoritative bookseller's organs, and it was left for the new reviews to inaugurate literary journalism of the more serious type. The Edinburgh Review suggested and first conducted in 1802. Samuel Taylor Coleridge, born in Devonshire in 1772, the youngest of the many children of a self-made clergyman and schoolmaster. He was a fantastic dreamer despised by other boys and unable to mingle with them. After the death of his father, he was sent to Christ Hospital, the Blue Coat Charity School in London, where he spent 9 lonely years in a manner briefly described in an essay of Charles Lamb, where Coleridge appears under a thin disguise. And very strict discipline was no doubt of much value in giving firmness and definite direction to his irregular nature, and the range of his studies, both in literature and other fields, was very wide. Through the aid of scholarship and of contributions from his brothers, he entered Cambridge in 1791. Coleridge left the university in 1794 without a degree, tormented by a disappointment in love. He had already begun to publish poetry and newspaper prose, and he now attempted lecturing. He and Southey married two sisters, whom Byron in later attack on Southey's somewhat inaccurately described as milliners of Bath, and Coleridge settled near Bristol. After characteristically varied and unsuccessful efforts at conducting a periodical, he moved with his wife in 1797 to Nether Stowey in Somersetshire. Expressly in order to be near him, Wordsworth and his sister Dorothy soon leased the neighboring manor house of Elphexden, and there followed the memorable year of intellectual and emotional stimulus when Coleridge's genius suddenly expanded into a short-lived but wonderful activity, and he wrote most of his few great poems, The Ancient Mariner, Cubahan, and the first part of Christabel. The Ancient Mariner was planned by Coleridge and Wordsworth on no one of their frequent rambles and was to have been written in collaboration. The final result of the incident, however, was the publication in 1798 of Lyrical Ballads, which included of Coleridge's work only this one poem, but of Wordsworth several of his most characteristic ones. Coleridge afterwards explained that the plan of the volume complementary sorts of poems. Like some other epoch-marking books, Lyrical Ballads attracted little attention. Shortly after its publication, Coleridge and the Wordsworth sailed for Germany, where for the greater part of a year Coleridge worked hard, if irregularly, at the language, literature, and philosophy. The remaining 35 years of his life are a record of ambitious projects and fitful efforts, for the most part turned by ill health and lack of steady purpose into a melancholy failure, but with a few fragmentary results standing out brilliantly. At times Coleridge did newspaper work at which he might have succeeded. William Wordsworth was born in 1770 in Cumberland, in the Lake region, which with its bold and varied mountains as well as its group of charming lakes is the most picturesque part of England proper. He had the benefit of all the available formal education, partly at home, partly at grammar school a few miles away, but his genius was formed chiefly by the influence of nature and in a qualified degree by that of the simple, pleasant people of the region. Already as a boy, though normal and active, he began to be sensitive to the divine power in nature, which in his mature years he was to express with deeper sympathy than any poet before him. In 1795, Wordsworth and his sister moved from the Lake region to Dorsetshire at the other end of England, likewise a country of great natural beauty. 2 years later came their change to Elphexden. The association with Coleridge, the Lyrical Ballads containing 19 of Wordsworth's poems. After their winter in Germany, the Wordsworths settled permanently in their native lake region, at first in Dove Cottage in the village of Grasmere. This simple little stone house, buried like all the other in the lake region in brilliant flowers and opening from its second story onto the hillside garden where Wordsworth composed much of his greatest poetry, is now the annual center of pilgrimage for thousands of visitors, one of the chief literary shrines of England and the world. Here Wordsworth lived frugally for several years. Then, after immediate changes, he took up his final residence in a larger house, Rydal Mount, a few miles away. In 1802, he married Mary Hutchinson, who had been one of his childish schoolmates, a woman of a spirit as fine as that of his sister. During the first half or more of his mature life, until long after he had ceased to be a significant creative force, Wordsworth's poetry, for reasons which will shortly appear, he had been met chiefly with ridicule and indifference, and he had been obliged to wait in patience while the slighter work first of Scott and then of Byron took the public by storm. Wordsworth, as we have said, is a chief representative of some of the most important principles in the Romantic movement. But he is far more than a member of any movement. Through his supreme poetic expression of some of the greatest spiritual ideas, he belongs among the five or six greatest English poets. First, he is the profoundest interpreter of nature in all poetry. His feelings of nature has two aspects. He is keenly sensitive and in a more delightfully discriminating way than any of his predecessors to all of the external beauty and glory of nature, especially in animate nature of mountains, woods and fields, streams and flowers in all their infinitely varied aspects. Wordsworth, more than any other great English poet, is a poet for nature and thoughtful appreciation. Except for a very small part of his work, many readers must gradually acquire the taste for him. But of his position among the half dozen English poets who have made the largest contribution to thought and life, there can be no question, so that some acquaintance with him is a necessary part of any real education. Robert Southey, a voluminous writer of verse and prose, who from his friendship with Wordsworth and Coleridge has been associated with them as third in what has been inaptly called the Lake School of Poets, was thought in his own day to be their equal. But time has relegated him to comparative obscurity. He wrote partly from irrepressible instinct and partly to support his own family and at times, as we have seen, that of Coleridge. His rather fantastic epics, composed with great facility and much real spirit, are almost forgotten. He is remembered chiefly by three or four short poems: The Battle of Blenheim, My Days Among the Dead Are Past, The Old Man's Comforts, and by his excellent short prose, Life of Nelson. Walter Scott was born in 1771 in Edinburgh, the son of an attorney of a privileged, though not the highest class. In spite of some serious sickness, one of which left him permanently lame, he was always a very active boy, more distinguished at school for play and fighting than for devotion to study. But his unconscious training for literature began very early. In his childhood, his love of poetry was stimulated by his mother, and he always spent much time in roaming about the country and picking up old ballads and traditional lore. Loyalty to his father led him to devote 6 years of hard work to the uncongenial study of the law, but at 20 he was admitted to the Edinburgh Bar as an advocate. Later, in 1806, he was also made one of the principal clerks of session, a subordinate but responsible office with a handsome salary, which entailed steady attendance and work at the Metropolitan Law Court in Edinburgh during half of each year. His instinct for literary production was first stimulated by the Germanic Romantic poets. In 1796, he translated Burgess's fiery and melodramatic ballad Lenore, and a little later wrote some vigorous though hastily ballads of his own. In 1802-1803, he published The Minstrelsy of the Scottish Border, a collection of Scottish ballads and songs, which he carefully annotated. He went on in 1805, when he was 34, to his first original verse romance, The Lay of the Last Minstrel. Carelessly constructed and written, this poem was nevertheless the most spirited reproduction of the life of feudal chivalry which the Romantic movement had yet brought forth, and its popularity was immediate and enormous. Always writing with the greatest facility, though in a brief hour's snatch from his other occupations, Scott followed up the lay during the next 10 years with the much superior Memnon, the Lady of the Lake, and other verse romances, most of which greatly increased both his reputation and his income. At the end of our lecture, conclusion. The term romanticism doesn't stem directly from the concept of love, but rather from the French word romant. Romanticism focuses on emotions and the inner life of the writer, and often uses autobiographical material to inform the work or even provide a template for it, unlike traditional literature at the time. Romanticism celebrated the primitive and elevated regular people as being deserving of celebration, which was an innovation at the time. Romanticism also fixated on nature as a primordial force and encouraged the concept of isolation as necessary for spiritual and aristocratic development. Here given the revision questions for self-checking.